So you have a meniscus tear. You've heard from your friends or your family that you might need surgery, and that scares you. Previously, almost everyone ended up with a surgery called a partial meniscectomy. However, the data is now clear. Surgery may actually be the wrong thing to do. I'm going to go over what the most recent clinical trials tell us about meniscus tear surgeries. We'll also talk about what I recommend to my patients instead. Hey everyone, Dr. Jeff Peng here. Meniscus injuries of the knees are super common, and there are lots of treatment options including a home exercise program, physical therapy, oral pain medications, injections, and meniscus tear surgery. But which one should you do? Which one's the best one? Almost everyone is surprised when I tell them what the most recent clinical trials show. But first, let's start with the basics. What are the meniscus? There are two in each knee, one on the inside of the knee called the medial meniscus and one on the outside of the knee called the lateral meniscus. The meniscus are cushions and they help pad and support the knee during movement. We categorize injuries to the meniscus into two types. There are acute tears and there are degenerative tears. Acute tears typically result from high energy twisting injuries or trauma. Think sports. Chronic tears are degenerative in nature and occur due to overuse and wear and tear. I'm going to focus this discussion only on the chronic degenerative meniscus tears. The reason meniscus tears are so problematic is because once they are torn, they don't heal well. And if you have a meniscus tear that doesn't heal, we thought the best way to address this was actually to cut it out. After all, it makes theoretical sense that if you have something that's broken, why not get rid of it? And it's for this exact reason that orthopedic surgeons used to perform a procedure called a total meniscectomy for those with meniscus tears. And a total meniscectomy actually means taking the entire meniscus out. But in practice, this actually proved to be a huge mistake. After the surgeons removed the meniscus, after they actually removed the padding between the bones, well, the bones started rubbing against each other more. This led to significant increased rates of degeneration as well as osteoarthritis. So then the next thing the surgeons thought to do is, well, if we can't cut the whole thing out, let's just cut part of it out. And in the last few years, arthroscopic partial meniscectomies have been one of the most common procedures performed in the United States, as well as worldwide. But should they be? These researchers published an eye-opening study looking at arthroscopic partial meniscectomy and a sham surgery for the treatment of degenerative meniscus tears. They took a total of 146 patients who had a meniscus tear confirmed during arthroscopy. These patients were then randomized into two groups while still in the operating room. Half of the patients ended up with an arthroscopic partial meniscectomy. They ended up getting the surgery. The other half got a sham surgery or a fake surgery. The researchers followed these patients over the course of 1 year, and what they found was that the surgical group had significant better outcomes at 1 year follow-up. What's shocking is that the sham surgery group also had significant improvement at the 1 year follow-up. There was no statistical difference in any of the outcomes between the two groups. What's fascinating is that these authors continue to follow the outcomes of these patients. Here are the conclusions after 2 years follow-up. The outcomes after arthroscopic partial meniscectomy were no better than those after placebo surgery. No evidence could be found to support the prevailing ideas that patients with presence of mechanical symptoms or certain meniscus tear characteristics, or those who have failed initial conservative treatment, are more likely to benefit from arthroscopic partial meniscectomy. It's actually very interesting that the researchers specifically mentioned the presence of mechanical symptoms or meniscus tear characteristics in their conclusions. The reason they did this is because after their initial study came out, surgeons started looking for other reasons to bring patients into the operating room. And they used mechanical symptoms or meniscus tear characteristics as a reason to operate. They believe that if you have a meniscus tear, well, that meniscus tear is causing the locking, the clicking, the popping, and the catching in your knee. And as long as you continue to have that meniscus tear, well, then you continue to have those symptoms. But this was actually investigated in another study. These researchers conducted an observational study examining how often a meniscus tear was present during surgery when a patient reported mechanical symptoms. The authors concluded that patient-reported mechanical symptoms were equally common, irrespective of presence or absence of a meniscal tear in patients undergoing arthroscopy for suspicion of a meniscal tear. Our findings suggest that mechanical knee symptoms have a limited value when considering indications for meniscal surgery. In fact, other researchers have specifically asked the question whether mechanical symptoms like clicking and popping and grinding and locking are actually even related to the meniscus at all. They concluded that mechanical knee symptoms are strongly associated with the burden and severity of underlying cartilage damage, rather than with specific meniscal pathology. It turns out mechanical symptoms are more likely related to underlying osteoarthritis rather than a meniscus tear. Researchers started to ask the question whether meniscus tears were even primary pain generators. They argued that just because a meniscus tear is present does not mean that that tear is the cause of your pain. In fact, just because you have a meniscus tear does not mean you have knee pain at all. These researchers published a systematic review and meta-analysis looking at the prevalence of meniscus tears on MRI. They found that 19% of patients over 40 years old had a meniscus tear, and the older your age, the more likely you are to have a tear. What this means is that if you have an MRI of your knee which shows a meniscus tear, it does not necessarily mean that that meniscus tear is the cause of your pain. You could be in that 19% and the meniscus tear could be an incidental finding. Let's go back to that initial study looking at arthroscopic partial meniscectomy as well as sham surgeries. Those same authors continued to follow their patients out for 5 years. The authors write, "Arthroscopic partial meniscectomy was associated with an increased risk of developing radiographic knee osteoarthritis and no concomitant benefit in patient-relevant outcomes at 5 years after surgery." There is long-term data that shows harm in performing an arthroscopic partial meniscectomy. It can increase the rate of developing knee osteoarthritis without any benefit to patient-related outcomes. Now I know what you're thinking at this time. What am I supposed to do to treat my meniscus tear? I thought surgery was my best option. And it turns out we may have actually been treating the wrong problem. Many people with degenerative meniscus tears actually have underlying osteoarthritis. We have been focusing so much of our attention on the meniscus tear that we may have ignored the cause of the meniscus tear, which could have been the underlying osteoarthritis. And so what is osteoarthritis? Well, I made an entire video dedicated to osteoarthritis, so check it out if you're interested. But in brief, osteoarthritis is caused by the gradual loss of articular cartilage. The articular cartilage actually works together with our meniscus to help keep our movements smooth and frictionless. However, loss of articular cartilage results in exposing the underlying bone, and the bone itself is more like a sandpaper material. So instead of having a smooth surface that glides along the meniscus, we have a sandpaper material that's grinding down on the meniscus. And so it makes so much sense now that if you have a sandpaper-like material grinding down on the meniscus, you're gonna have a degenerative meniscus tear. And rather than treating the meniscus tear, we should have been treating the underlying osteoarthritis. Instead, what we were telling people to do was to cut out the meniscus tear. This caused the loss of even more padding and contributed to the progression of osteoarthritis. So hopefully I've convinced you not to jump straight to surgery for your meniscus tear. But then what are non-surgical options to treat osteoarthritis as well as to treat meniscus tears? Well, physical therapy and a home exercise program are actually excellent treatment options. These researchers performed a cross-sectional study looking at participants with knee pain and MRI-confirmed degenerative meniscus tears. They found that patients had significantly weaker quadriceps and lower extremity strength on their injured leg when compared to their non-injured leg. And this supports treating meniscus tears with muscle strengthening. Weakness leads to biomechanical imbalances and problems. This can lead to more wear and tear, and more wear and tear leads to more osteoarthritis as well as more degenerative meniscus tears. So addressing any underlying biomechanical problem or weakness through strengthening and a rehabilitation program can actually help improve pain. Clinical trials also support physical therapy to treat meniscus injuries. These researchers performed a systematic review and meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials comparing arthroscopic partial meniscectomy to physical therapy in patients with degenerative meniscus tears. They concluded that the literature provides relatively strong evidence that surgery did not improve functional activity or reduce pain compared with the results of conservative treatment. Now, there is plenty of evidence that physical therapy can help patients with meniscus tears. But what if people are in so much pain that they can't do effective rehab? Rather than rushing to the operating room, there are other ways to decrease pain, and injections seem like the best way to do that. Cortisone injections have been around forever and they can reduce pain. but their use is fading away due to concerns of toxicity. And we are moving towards using orthobiologics such as platelet-rich plasma as first-line treatment for osteoarthritis with or without degenerative meniscus tears. You can check out my video on PRP injections in osteoarthritis to learn more. The evidence is growing day by day that platelet-rich plasma injections may be the best way to treat knee pain and knee symptoms. Make an informed decision about your knee and your health. Don't jump straight to surgery for degenerative meniscus tears. Treat the underlying osteoarthritis. And please share this video if you found it useful. Please also consider liking the video and subscribing to my channel. You can find me on social media. I'm on Twitter @JeffreyPengMD, and I write on my blog at JeffreyPengMD.com.